Hello and welcome to Westminster Watch. It's Thursday, the 17th of September. I'm Professor Dermot Hodson from the Department of Politics at Birkbeck, and I'm joined as usual by my colleague, Dr. Ben Worthy. We're here to talk about issues in the news that are of relevance for the study of contemporary British politics, and we have two issues we'd like to talk about this week, beginning with the prospects of Scottish independence and the road to a referendum. So, okay, over to you, Ben, to set out your take on whether we're headed for a second independence referendum and what you expect the dynamics of that referendum to be.
Okay, so as most listeners probably know, it seems that the dynamics around Scottish independence are changing once again. Seven different polls this year and last year in a row have put the yes vote ahead of the no vote. Not by a long way, but they've definitely put them ahead. And this again raises the question about what might happen in the future as the yes vote moves from being in the kind of low 40s up towards 50%+. Now, of course, part of this is the fact that there are Remainers in Scotland who have switched towards Scottish independence out of sort of desperation and unhappiness with the situation over Brexit. I think, and here we might disagree, I think now, in a sense, looked at it from the viewpoint of a support of Scottish independence is the perfect time. You have Nicola Sturgeon, a very popular leader. You have both the Scottish Conservatives, who've just lost their leader, and the Scottish Labour Party, whose leader is almost subject to a no-confidence vote. And you see a great deal of turbulence in Scottish politics that would help an independence vote. There's kind of two big questions hanging over it now. Question one is how and whether this could actually happen. Boris Johnson yesterday in Parliament said he wouldn't allow a second referendum to take place. And then the second question, again, which I think we'll probably disagree about, is to what extent the vote could happen and there could be a vote towards Scottish independence, and how the different sides think about independence and what motivates voters to move in one direction or the other. I think we've definitely discussed the legal technicalities of this before. It leaves open this kind of grey area around what happens if the UK Prime Minister doesn't want a referendum to take place. Does it end up in the Supreme Court in a kind of messy and controversial case or ruling? Could we look at something like a sort of a consultative referendum with no sort of official status, and where would that lead us?
So I guess my thoughts on referendums in this country is that they ultimately serve the interests of the executive, the government of the day. And I guess all the reasons why you talk about this being a good moment for a referendum must surely be the reason why Boris Johnson wouldn't go for it, right? I can see why there's pressure building up on him, but I don't think it's so intense that he can't withstand that pressure and leave it to the next occupant of number 10 to deal with it as a problem. You know, if you look at past referendums, and of course there haven't been that many in this country compared to certainly other political systems, we see prime ministers going for referendums when it suits their interests. So in 1975, Wilson loses control over the issue of Europe in his own party and calls a referendum that he's fairly optimistic about winning. So too David Cameron, it's just that his optimism was misplaced. Or we look at the AV referendum, this was a very neat way for Cameron to kill the issue. So I don't really see what's in it for Johnson, precisely because the terms of the debate have shifted to make independence, the case for independence, I think, so much stronger. I mean, on that case, I think that Brexit has been an important game changer. I think one of the strongest arguments against Scottish independence in 2014 was the uncertainty over whether Scotland would be offered membership of the European Union. There was a lot of resistance to that from EU leaders at the time, particularly those who were concerned about the prospect of breakaway secessionist movements in Spain. This may well have changed because of Brexit. There may well be sympathy towards the idea of Scottish independence. I was very struck by members of the European Parliament singing Auld Lang Syne in the final hours of Britain's membership of the European Union. Sentimental gesture, to be sure, but one that suggested that Europe would, and I quote, leave a light on for Scotland. So there would certainly be, I think, a lot of pressure on the European Union to act differently, and that might change the terms of the debate. It also affects the mandate, right? Scotland was promised that a vote for union in 2014 would mean a vote for EU membership. Of course, that's been torn up. And I think that changes the terms of the debate. I think COVID has also slightly changed the terms of the debate. It's very difficult to directly compare Scotland and England in terms of how exposed they've been. But if we just look at raw numbers, there's been 2,500 deaths in Scotland compared to nearly 37,000 in England. There's a perception, and it may well just be that, that Nicola Sturgeon has been much safer in her handling of the crisis. And indeed, Boris Johnson has often followed her lead, for example, performing a U-turn over the issue of face masks in schools. It's really clear, from the polls at least, that Nicola Sturgeon has seen her standing increase as a result of the crisis. She's got a net approval rating of plus 50 in Scotland, whereas Boris Johnson's is minus 50. He's in a really weak position. But again, I'd argue, Ben, that that would decrease the likelihood that Johnson would press go on a referendum.
Yeah, I'd slightly modify what you said by saying that would decrease the likelihood that Boris Johnson would want to press no. And I just want to stop there and pause on those two numbers you said. Nicola Sturgeon's ratings are plus 50. That is extraordinary for a politician. And it is, and I'm gonna stick my neck out here and say that is extraordinary for the longest serving party leader in the United Kingdom to be in that kind of position. And the pollsters who look at this in Scotland, John Curtis's What Scotland Thinks, have said that there have been mentions, it's slightly anecdotal, of the way in which Nicola Sturgeon has handled COVID, particularly with her daily press conferences. If you've watched those, they're extremely kind of well managed and very competently done, and are daily, has made a difference in how people perceive it. The danger for Johnson is that it isn't just Remainers now switching to Scottish independence out of unhappiness, but it does look like Leavers are moving too. The question then is, the Scottish Nationalist Party won a number of seats in the 2019 general election on an explicit mandate of a second independence referendum. If the SNP again do very well at the Holyrood elections in May, that will be a double democratic mandate for a second referendum. And my question, it's open one, is whether Boris Johnson can kind of avoid and resist the pressure for a call for a second referendum. I would argue that he's not quite as good at resisting pressure as you seem to say he is.
Let's suppose you're right, and let's suppose that we see a second Scottish independence referendum. How is it going to play out? My feeling is that whatever the moral case for Scottish independence might be, I think it remains a very hard political sell. And I think one of the main stumbling blocks will be the issue of a Scottish currency. We've seen some interesting manoeuvres on this behind the scenes in Scotland. It was a pretty devastating issue for the SNP in the last independence referendum. This question of whether Scotland would have its own currency, whether it would be forced to join the euro. It wouldn't, in my view, but it still created that kind of uncertainty. And so the proposal last time was that Scottish independence would be followed by a currency union with the rest of the UK. And this was a very difficult political sell, especially when the rest of the UK pushed back and said, well, we wouldn't want that. You know, we wouldn't want a monetary union. So how has the SNP handled this issue since 2014? Well, it's had various consultations, but it's come up with the idea of what's called sterlingisation, which is one of the uglier terms you'll ever hear on this podcast. But it basically means that Scotland will unilaterally tie itself to sterling and thereby maintain that link. And I mean, this is kind of a clever move on some level by the SNP because it doesn't need buy-in from the UK for that currency arrangement. But it's still messy potentially because it's basically saying vote for political independence while we give away some of our economic independence in return for that, right? We don't have the economic levers as an independent country that you might expect. We don't have a Scottish interest rate that we could raise or lower according to developments in the Scottish economy. So I think there's a real contradiction there, right, between the economics of independence and the politics of it. And I think for that reason, among others, independence will be a real hard sell.
I've been thinking about voters because there's been some great work. For anybody who's read the book Democracy for Realists, which is a kind of rethinking of why voters vote how they do, a kind of rejection of the old-fashioned idea that voters are supremely rational, that collectively people somehow come to a sort of rational conclusion, or that they vote retrospectively on what it is that people do. Instead, the argument is, and there's some research more recently to back this up, particularly in terms of Scotland, is that it's social identity that determines how people vote. And one of the interesting pieces of research that came out of the Scottish independence referendum by Ed Fieldhouse and Chris Prosser is the argument that how people voted in the referendum then changed their social and political identity. So Labour voters who went for independence, then to close the kind of cognitive gap in how they thought, then switched to becoming SNP supporters afterwards. So my argument is that once people have made the leap of moving party and with it their social identities, matters around arguments like the one you cite there become less relevant because they're seen through a partisan lens. How you view, for example, the actions of the EU in the negotiations, and there were some pretty interesting claims about the EU made in the liaison committee yesterday, is entirely determined by your partisanship. So lots of these issues, these detailed issues, just like we saw with Brexit, will be heavily kind of understood and seen through a very partisan lens. You know, people won't say, oh, I fear the effects of the currency because of X, because they'll have already decided whether they're yes or no. And that will then filter.
My thought is that, you know, the Brexit referendum, one of the great strengths of the Leave campaign is that they were able to sketch the future in incredibly broad economic terms. It was about trade deals. It was about freedom. It was about the absence of regulation, everything that we don't see now. But they had a kind of very idealistic vision of a post-Brexit economy. I think that's very different than the kind of realities of governing as an independent country, right? I can imagine that nitty-gritty really pushing through in the debate. But we'll see. So, okay, watch this space on A, whether the referendum would happen, and B, how difficult it would be to sell the idea of Scottish independence. Okay, moving on to the second issue in the news this week is the question of civil service reform. Last week, we saw Sir Jonathan Jones quit as Treasury Solicitor and head of the Government Legal Service. This was, we think, over disagreements behind the scenes over the Internal Market Bill, which we talked about in the last podcast, and its actual potential breach of international law. This brings to six the number of permanent secretaries that have walked or been pushed under the Johnson ministry. So in recent months, we've seen Jonathan Slater sacked over the A-level fiasco, sacked as permanent secretary of the Department for Education. We saw Sir Richard Heaton step down from Justice. We saw Sir Simon MacDonald leave the FCO. We saw Sir Philip Rutman depart from the Home Office. And of course, we saw Sir Mark Sedwell, the chief civil servant, that is the cabinet secretary, unceremoniously defenestrated to make way for a new holder of this, Simon Case. It's hard not to see these resignations and sackings as anything other than part of this government's very ambitious yet also quite nebulous vision for civil service reform. And I think the clearest articulation of this was seen in Michael Gove's extraordinary speech in July when he gave the Ditchley lecture under the title of The Privilege of Public Service. I wonder if those permanent secretaries felt it was worth that privilege when they were encouraged or forced to step down. What are the big themes of Gove's speech? And I'd really urge you to read it if you haven't done so already. He's a deep thinker, probably the deepest thinker in government. There's a real willingness to tackle big themes. You know, when else does a speech on civil service reform, a potentially quite dry topic, make the headlines? When Michael Gove gives it. And when Michael Gove starts off with a quote from Antonio Gramsci, a thinker not associated with conservative politicians, although this is the second time that Gramsci cropped up in a Gove speech. What kind of civil service does he want? He wants a less metropolitan one. He talks about the need for civil service to move to, for example, Teesside, Humberside, Aberdeen. He wants civil servants trained in statistics and mathematics. He wants a civil servant who can understand the Monte Carlo method, a statistical technique that I suspect didn't feature in Gove's own undergraduate studies in English literature. He wants more specialists. He wants you know, an expert on agricultural policy to remain in agriculture and to move through the ranks rather than moving department for the sake of career ambitions. He wants civil servants to be more innovative. What's going on with all these departures from the top tier of government, Ben, and Gove's Gramsci in turn?
It's interesting that Michael Gove thinks of himself as a radical who changed institution, tried to change political landscapes and changed how people thought. So I suppose that's the link. It was interesting that Michael Gove is seen as the kind of intellectual heart of this government, because if you contrast his very kind of well thought through ideas against Johnson's answers yesterday at the liaison committee when he was asked about the civil service, he managed to mention the Northcote Trevelyan principles. He was very hazy on the difference between types of accountability, and his only kind of giveaway about potential reform was that he venerated the civil service and whatever he did would be within the tradition of it and it would all be good, and he was a very big fan of civil servants. Kind of went like that. One thing to bear in mind is that kind of Gove's radical let's transform the institutions actually meets with Boris Johnson's more kind of day-to-day experience of civil servants, because one of the few parts of the UK political system where it's kind of accepted that you have this American style throw out of officials every time you come in is actually the Mayor of London, which was begun by Ken Livingstone and then carried on by Boris Johnson, where the top tier of officials were, in some senses, became sort of de facto political appointees and were removed and replaced with each kind of new administration. So you can see that kind of the practicalities of Boris Johnson's experience, and he begins like one in every three sentences with the words, "When I was mayor of this great city," matches with Gove's kind of radical vision. And by the way, that's classic Gove to kind of, you know, to pivot left when actually you're going right. And it's designed to confuse his enemies and to an extent impress them in that he's opened a book on Gramsci and is aware of his existence.
Yeah. How far we got into this book, I think, is the matter of debate. I guess my reaction to this is that there could be something new here, but it's also same old, same old. I think it's hard to remember a government that wasn't frustrated on some level with the civil service and open to the idea of systemic large-scale reform or disruptive gestures. If you go back to Tony Blair, the decision to allow Alistair Campbell, his communications chief, to issue instructions directly to civil servants was incendiary at the time, right? It was considered to be a major breach of the traditional forms of accountability that we see in the civil service. If we go back to Thatcher, we see, for example, Sir Derek Rayner, former head of Marks and Spencers, appointed to drive through efficiency savings in the civil service, which amounted to cuts of 16,000 jobs on average per year. Thatcher herself, deeply distrustful of the ideology or the kind of economic ideas at the heart of government when she took over, she tried to sideline the Treasury, bringing in her own advisor, Alan Walters. And the influence of her own advisors on economic policy was one of the reasons why Nigel Lawson walked as Chancellor of the Exchequer, and this ultimately led to Thatcher's downfall too. So we had those tensions under Thatcher. If we go back even further, we see, of course, changes in the 1960s, the Fulton Report, and it's interesting to see the kind of echoes of that report on the reform of the civil service, arguing that we need more specialists, right, that we're too generalists. And that brings us kind of full circle to Dominic Cummings, who's probably the real pseudo-intellectual behind some of these ideas. He gave a reduced version of that speech in his infamous blog post, which called for, and I quote, "misfits and weirdos to come into government." Cummings' kind of disruptive vision is behind this too. But I think there's also something new going on here. It's the idea that civil servants need to have certain values in common with the government. You know, I think this emphasis on big data, on the Monte Carlo method, is a kind of smokescreen for politicization. So I would agree with you on that. That hasn't necessarily served the US very well, right? And I think a common feature of the early months and sometimes years of a presidency in the United States is seeing the top three levels of governance often empty because they haven't been confirmed by the Senate. It's very difficult to interact with new administrations in the US because there's so many kind of gaps in that governance architecture. But I think we are seeing politicization. My concern is that the departure of these permanent secretaries could have a chilling effect on future civil servants, right? If they're so publicly thrown under the bus, how might that affect their advice in the future? How might civil servants internalize some of these political constraints? And what effect might that have on their neutral advice?
Absolutely. I mean, just a few thoughts to add to that is one is that it's extraordinarily disruptive to keep removing people. Extraordinarily disruptive. It saps morale. People are upset. It causes problems and distractions. A second, as you say, it's part of this very long trope. In fact, there was a whole comedy series based around it with Yes Minister, whereby ministers want to do all these radical important things and officials are trying to stop them, persuade them out of it, push it into the machinery, delay, etc., etc. Now, that isn't necessarily true. I think a lot of politicians think that is the case. I mean, for a government with a supposedly radical agenda, it's also a very effective way of distracting yourself. You know, take actions like this against the people who will get it done for them and implement the actual policy. And it could be immensely counterproductive and a kind of a sign that, that some of the radical things that they want done aren't necessarily going to happen.
You know, these reform initiatives take time to play out. And an intriguing possibility would be what would happen if Keir Starmer inherited this civil service reform portfolio if he became Prime Minister. He would, by my reckoning, become the first very high-ranking civil servant to make it to the top of British politics since Harold Wilson. Starmer was, of course, director of the Crown Prosecution Service. Wilson was director of Economic and Statistics in the Ministry of Fuel and Power. So an intriguing question is how Starmer, as a former very experienced civil servant, would handle the issue of civil service reform, whether he would see the blob, as Cummings calls it, getting in his way, or whether he would have other issues or agendas in mind there. If you'd like to learn more about research on politics at Birkbeck, about Birkbeck Centre for British Political Life, and about the range of undergraduate, postgraduate and doctoral programmes we offer, please visit our website at www.bbk.ac.uk/politics. Thanks for listening and stay tuned for more Westminster Watch.